Good afternoon. My name is Deborah Freeman, and on behalf of LaRouche PAC, I'd like to welcome all of you to today's historic event. Undoubtedly, many of you commented prior to today's event and coming into today's event on the timing of it, the fact that it was scheduled to take place the day after the critical primaries in Indiana and North Carolina. What I would say to you today, and what I think Mr. LaRouche will make unmistakably clear, is that, in fact, what kept the nation riveted to their TV screens last night was really not very much different than any other primetime drama that they were watching. That, in fact, they did not understand what was really being played out. Because indeed, what we are facing in our nation today is not simply a primary election campaign. We are not facing a race between two Democrats and then ultimately between a Democrat and a Republican. What we are facing in our nation is what we have faced in this nation since the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. And that is a war for the survival of Republican forces, uniquely American forces, against those of the British Empire. And today, that war has come to its final stage. Where things go in the United States and in the world at large will not be decided at some political convention in August, nor will it be decided at some general election in November. The strategic questions which determine the future of this nation and, in fact, the future of the planet will be determined today, will be determined based on how the leadership of this nation responds to the strategic questions before us right now. Both as a former presidential candidate, as a statesman, as an economist, and as the chairman and founder of this political action committee, Lyndon LaRouche has put those questions before the U.S. population repeatedly. And in fact, it has been the organizing of his movement that has already largely shaped the issues in this ongoing national election in the United States. But the fact is that not enough of the American people yet understand what is at stake. And not enough of the leaders or would-be leaders of our nation understand what is at stake. I think that Mr. LaRouche's presentation today will go a long way toward helping them to understand precisely that. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Lyndon LaRouche.
Thank you all. Thank you, Deborah. The issue is not the election. The election is a battle in a war. It is not something unto itself. The result of this election in itself is a matter of indifference. It's a question of how the battle is won and lost, which is important. We have obviously two disasters running for president. Though one has a good constituency, that is, Obama has a very large constituency, which is important. It is sensitive to the lower 80% of family income brackets, as the top of the Obama campaign is not. It's on the other side. But the Hillary's campaign is significant. But the issue is that forces in Britain, with their stooges in the United States, have said that a Hillary Clinton election, even a nomination, would mean that Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton would be in the White House. And this, the British Empire, such as it is, and its lackeys in Washington and elsewhere, are determined it shall not happen. And you're talking about methods such as assassination, if deemed necessary to prevent Hillary from becoming president. It was not just the Republicans who turned out en masse to vote for Obama in yesterday's Indiana and also North Carolina campaigns. That's what the margin was there. That's not the issue. That's part of the fraud. This was a gigantic fraud. I sat there at the television set and watched this thing coming down the last phases, and I saw something that from my nose I could see the stink all over the place. This election was totally fraudulent. Exactly how the fraud was exercised, we know one thing. There was a massive turnout of Republican and related vote for Obama in Raleigh-Durham. In contrast to other cities in North Carolina, where the expected result was going along until the last minute, when a miracle occurred, voters who had not yet been born were flooding the polls at the last minute of the polls. We've seen this sort of thing before. So the issue is not, but there's another issue here. It's also an issue of World War III. And World War III is between the British Empire, better known as the Anglo-Dutch liberal banking financial system on the one side, and the principal nations of Eurasia, Russia, China, India, and other nations are the targets of intended warfare by the British Empire, which is already turning Europe into continental Europe into a mere colony of the British Empire through the program of the Lisbon Treaty. If the Lisbon Treaty were adopted, and it's being pushed for adoption now, there would not be a single nation on the continent of Europe west of Belarus and Russia which had any sovereignty whatsoever. The British Empire would control the entirety of that region of Europe, from Portugal to the borders of Belarus and Russia, as a puppet of the Anglo-Dutch liberal financial interests. It is those interests represented in the United States who have, for a long time, especially since 1971-72, have taken over control of the US dollar, control of the United States. Now they're moving in for the kill. And that's the issue. The issue is the fools think that in the Democratic Party, they're all, the people at the top are generally largely corrupt in this thing. They're lying their heads off. I watched some of them lie on television. I lost some of the television commentators lying like hell about what was going on right under their nose on television. And you could see the facts and you could see what they were saying, two different things. But you're looking at a war between an empire run by London, not necessarily all the British people, but it's by the Anglo-Dutch liberal financier cartel. The same cartel that put Mussolini into power in Italy, the same cartel that put Hitler into power in Germany. And we're now at the brink of something like a Hitler power taking over the United States. If they grab the United States, then they will grab all of Europe under the Lisbon Treaty. If they control the United States and the parts of Europe under the Lisbon Treaty, then you will have an actual fighting war emerging on this planet against the continent of Africa and much of the continent of Asia and other places. You will have dictatorship. You will have mass starvation, the elimination of whole sections of the population of parts of the world through starvation. And that's part of the British program. It's the food war. We now have a situation which I'll get into on the background. But that's the situation. We're not dealing with an election. We're dealing with whether there is in the United States, in the top layers of society, the moral fitness to survive. And so far, the vote is in the leadership of the Democratic Party and the Republican Party, neither is morally fit to survive. They're as unmorally fit to survive as the people who backed Mussolini and backed Hitler back in the 1920s and the 1930s. And if we allow this to happen, we will get the same kind of treatment that the victims of Mussolini, Hitler, and so forth suffered. That's where we stand. We have to win this war against that evil empire. That's been the long-standing fight. For me, it's a long-standing fight ever since I had service in Asia toward the end of the last World War, where I was in northern Burma, now called Myanmar, and in Calcutta area, in Bengal. And I saw the British Empire face up in those circumstances and elsewhere. I know the British Empire. Truman was a victim of British Empire. Look at what, there's just a case of this thing. Franklin Roosevelt, the intention, at the close of World War II, before he died, his intention at that period, was to eliminate colonialism and all forms of imperialism for this planet. His intention was that once the peace had been secured, that the power of the United States, developed through its agro-industrial and scientific power, which is the greatest power this planet had ever seen from any single source, if this power was going to be used by converting the war machine, which the United States had assembled to deal with the war against Hitler, to assemble that machine and transform it into a machine of production. And as Roosevelt spelled out specifically, to take nations and continents like Africa, the colonial nations of the world, and free them, not only by giving them political freedom, but by giving them economic assistance and technology to solve their problems, where they could emerge from being colonies and pray to being essentially self-determining. And Roosevelt's intention for the United Nations was to perform a receptacle called the United Nations as an assembly of nations, including many which would be newly created as freed from former colonies to sovereign national status. And the minute that that pig, Truman, walked in to replace Roosevelt, within hours after Roosevelt's death, Truman went to the side of Churchill. And Churchill's policy was to prevent Franklin Roosevelt from succeeding, his policy from succeeding, because the British were determined to maintain their empire, as they are determined in the case of Zimbabwe and against Mbeki in South Africa today. They're determined to destroy the United States as they have been since the inception of the United States in the revolt against the Paris Peace of 1763, at which the British moved immediately, the British East India Company, moved to impose imperial power over the people in North America, to take away the rights of the states, to take away the rights of the citizens, to deny us the right to have industry, to crush our agriculture, and to loot us. And we went to war, not seeking war, but seeking independence. We went to war against the British Empire. Let me tell you a story before I get into this, the main point here. It's an important one. Important part of history. Most people in this country and other countries today are rather stupid when it comes to reality. I mean that in a very specific sense. Because no longer do they believe in successive generations, no longer do they believe in the immortality of the individual personality. That even after the individual is dead, their personality continues to live and have an effect on future generations. We used to have a society which we thought grandfathers would give their lives to provide a better way of life for the, not only their children, but especially their grandchildren. The relationship of the grandfather to the grandchildren, particularly in terms of our immigrant population, which came here often working in poverty, working their way up. And the laborer who came from Italy became the grandson, became a doctor, became a scientist, or became something else of skill. This was called the land of opportunity because that was our policy. But this was also a European policy. The policy that we are not simply animals, we are not monkeys who die, who go out of existence. Just our name is maybe remembered by an owner or a monkey. But we are human, and we have the capability, the creative powers that no animal has. We're able to use those creative powers for the future of mankind. And thus, even after we die, what we contribute through those powers lives on. And our influence radiates, our personality radiates in a useful way to coming generations. That has been lost. We have now become, especially with the 68ers and that generation, which lost their morality almost at birth. No, actually, this is something that was done to them. Don't blame them entirely for it. It was done to them by their parents and the consent of their parents, and done by teachers and so forth. They lost that sense of immortality. They lost the sense of culture. They lost the sense of a continuity of culture. They don't lost a sense of what the meaning is of national cultures or cultures of people, the importance of preserving and promoting those cultures, because that's the way in which a people can deal with its problems. That's the way the creative powers of the mind can be summoned. You can't have a Tower of Babel, such as globalization. You want to develop a people, you must develop them in their souls. You must develop them in their culture, in their minds. The results you come to may be the same as in a different culture. But the way in which you get there is through the culture of that people. And you promote and defend that culture and seek to promote independent nations which represent each of these cultures. And then bring the cultures together in cooperation for a common purpose, the common aims of mankind. We lost that. It was taken away from us, as Roosevelt was taken from us by death, and we were given Truman instead. What did Truman do? Immediately, on behalf of the great British Empire, Truman took the power of the United States and used it to reinforce recolonization and to accept imposed forms of colonization which were worse than mere colonization. That happened in Africa. There are no really free nations. None. They have degrees of freedom. But the freedom is conditional. And the conditional freedom is run now from London. It's a colony. Who made it a colony? The United States made it a colony precisely contrary to the intention of Franklin Roosevelt, who specified the development of Africa among the other objectives of the United States for the post-war period. Truman supported the British. Indochina, which had been freed by its own efforts with the support of the United States under Ho Chi Minh, under Roosevelt. This nation, the Japanese who had surrendered to the Vietnamese, suddenly were on orders of London with the support of Harry Truman, were freed. The Japanese soldiers were given their guns back and taken out of the camps to reoccupy Indochina, to turn it over to the British immediately, who would then turn it over to their suckers, the French. Look at that whole region. Indonesia. The Indonesian people had largely freed themselves from Japanese and Dutch occupation. And what did we do? The Anglo-Americans reinforced the colonization of Indonesia. Finally, the Indonesians got a conditional freedom, but their essential freedom was to be taken away from them. A similar thing happened in India. India got a qualified freedom, but the British kept a stranglehold on it, as Nehru saw at the time when the rupee was devalued, and India was put into a condition of slavery as a result. That's the condition in Africa. That's the condition of Southwest Asia. That's the conditions that were imposed wherever the United States was weak, in South and Central America. And so we went from a nation that we had been to a Truman nation, a nation which was a lackey of the British Empire. And we had centered in New York City in particular, but other locations, financial institutions, like the grandfather of the present president of the United States, Prescott Bush. Prescott Bush personally signed the order to release funds from a German bank to put Hitler into power. The grandfather of the present president of the United States.
What a fine family tradition that is. I mean, you have a coke addict, a so-called recovering coke addict, who's now sitting as the president of the United States under the management of a baboon called the vice president, who was run in turn by George Shultz from the West Coast, the guy who put Pinochet into power in Chile, together in collaboration with Felix Rahatan, who runs the Speaker of the House in the Congress today. And Felix Rahatan was an accomplice of George Shultz in putting the fascist dictatorship of Pinochet into power in the Southern Cone. It was under this arrangement that veteran Nazis were brought into South America and conducted this operation of Nazi-like murder throughout the Southern Cone of South America. This is what the problem is. And people say, how can you talk about the British that way? They're our cousins. Well, see, it's not really the British. That's another story, which I won't go into here. But essentially, what we call the British Empire, or the Anglo-Dutch Liberal Financier Empire, is an Anglo-Dutch operation based on Venice, which is a syndicate of financiers, individual financiers who, in a group, form a kind of a locust horde. And this locust horde controls, one example, 1971, a stooge for London called Richard Nixon, who was elected by the weatherman, actually, that is the weatherman revolt of the fascist faction of the 68ers, split the Democratic Party between the blue collar and the dirty uncollared college students. And therefore, the split of the Democratic Party in 1968, as occurred also in Europe, similar operation, destroyed the Democratic Party and thus elected Richard Nixon. And what did you get with Nixon? Nixon was a fascist. His regime was fascist. We fought it off, but we didn't uproot it. And all through the 1970s, the same thing, from 1969 to 1981, the United States was destroyed as an economy in its essential characteristics. And the continued rot went on from there. The rot started, the decline of the U.S. economy actually started. The frustration of the U.S. economy started with Truman. Truman was the bastard to hate, if you want to say, oh, what's wrong with the 68ers. You don't like baby boomers? Blame Harry Truman. He gave birth to all of them by some mysterious force. But then again, you have the same thing, the 68ers, the children of Truman, the white-collar class, the children of Truman, gave us Nixon. And you got three Rockefeller brothers, Nelson, John D., and so forth. And the three of them, with the aid of the Trilateral Commission, destroyed the U.S. economy on the inside during the period of their control during the 1970s. And it was the Trilateral Commission of David Rockefeller which led the thing, and poor Jimmy Carter didn't know what the devil was happening to him. He was just listening to Mr. Rockefeller, the guy who put the $3 million into the coffer to run the Carter campaign, to launch it. And Jimmy now had been a good ex-president, but he was a terrible president. And it's always it's not good to have a president who's a wind-up toy for a Rockefeller. So we were destroyed. Once the Soviet Union collapsed, what happened? Another change called globalization occurred. There's no longer a Soviet power to contend with. So therefore, what do? We strip Germany of its economy. How's it done? By Margaret Thatcher and Mitterrand. And Mitterrand, the French president of that time, was a stooge of the British. I know it personally. I had meetings in London on that subject where they said, no, Mitterrand is our man. We own him. Mitterrand, the president of France, was a stooge of the British monarchy. And Mitterrand and Margaret Thatcher destroyed Germany, and it's still being destroyed today as other countries as a result of that. That is, German technology developed in Germany is now used in various countries like the Transrapid in China, but it doesn't exist in Germany. All nuclear power virtually does not exist in Germany. where it did exist is being torn down. Technology is being destroyed, all for the sake of the British Empire. Even worse, in the economy. You will find that what has happened with globalization, and it affects people in this country very much, what they've done is they've taken industries, manufacturing industries in particular, agriculture in particular, and countries which were good agricultural producers or good manufacturing producers have been stripped of those industries. Those industries have been taken to populations where the lower 80% of the population is illiterate. So you have colonies of manufacturing in countries in Asia, Africa, and so forth, South America, where the people, the 80% of the population, does not participate in the economy. You have areas which used to be food-producing areas which no longer produce food. Because what you're having is a world dictatorship under the name of globalization, better called the New Tower of Babel, in which the cultures are being destroyed as the United States is being destroyed, as Germany is being destroyed, as Italy is being destroyed, as France is being destroyed, and the attempt to make war on China, India, and Russia. And that's the intent of the British Empire. Nothing less than destruction and breakup of China, the breakup of Russia, the breakup of India. That is the policy of the British Empire now. That's the policy they're condemning. The policy is to take every nation of continental Europe, west of Belarus and west of Russia. And under the Lisbon Treaty, which is now being voted up by many institutions of government in continental Europe, strips every nation of Europe from the Atlantic Ocean to the border of Belarus and Russia and will have no sovereignty. That is, there will be no government which has the authority to contradict the Lisbon Treaty Organization. The NATO is intended to be absorbed by the Lisbon Treaty. And the forces of Europe, which are not NATO forces, will be combined with NATO forces for warfare against points east. Russia, former parts of the Soviet Union other than Russia, China, Korea, India, as well as Southwest Asia, where they're doing an excellent job of mutilating the whole countryside. This is what we're dealing with. The intention here is to eradicate the United States, among other objectives, because as long as we exist, we are a problem. Let me just go back one more point on this before getting to the economic questions I want to deal with today. Let me go with the economic question as such, because when it goes into this, we'll probably get it in the question and answer period later. It's better, less tiring for the audience to make things. Anyway, but what happened relevantly now to this present situation is approximately 9 months ago, slightly more, on the 25th of July of last year, 2007, I made a statement here in this forum, which I said that a new general breakdown crisis of the financial system was now in progress. 3 days later, we had the beginning of what some fools called the subprime crisis. It was not the subprime crisis. Some of you have seen a building torn down by explosives, and where you blow it out from the underneath and the building collapses into the area where you explode it. That's what the subprime crisis really was. The subprime crisis was the weak underbelly of a large financial system which was collapsing. But the collapse was not the collapse of the subprime system. The collapse was the collapse of the entire international financial monetary system, which has now entered into a very visibly a hyperinflationary phase. We are now globally in a hyperinflationary phase. So at that time, on the 25th of last July, I introduced one then of several measures which I had crafted for defense of the United States in particular against this crisis which is would broke out. That is this new world depression. This is more than a depression. It's something like what happened to Europe during the middle of the 14th century when the Bank of Lucca, the House of Bari, went bankrupt and all Europe plunged into a new dark age. We are now in a period where the world as a whole is in the process of collapsing into a new dark age, similar to, but worse than, potentially, unless we stop it, worse than that happened to Europe in the middle of the 14th century. That's the situation we're in. Now, the measures I proposed were, first of all, the HBPA. That is to federal legislation, which we're now getting supporting legislation for in states, which means that the households' mortgages will not be foreclosed, but rather the households which are affected will be put into receivership as protection, bankruptcy protection, and allowed to stay in their homes, paying a reasonable fee in the form of something equivalent to rent for that instead of this mortgage process until we can straighten the mess out. We don't want to destroy the communities. We don't want to destroy the people. We don't want to have people. Let's keep people in their places. That way, we've got a structure to begin with. Then if you're going to do that, you've got to do something else, which is the second part of the thing. You have to provide bankruptcy security to the banks. That is the chartered banks, the federal banks and the state banks. Because if the federal and state banks in communities begin to disintegrate, you don't have an organized community anymore. So therefore, forget the Federal Reserve, send Bernanke back with his helicopter beanie, whatever it is, and send him back to where he belongs, and put the Federal Reserve System itself, which is bankrupt, in fact, by virtue of its members being bankrupt, put it into receivership under the U.S. Treasury Department, where it still functions, the offices are there, the people are there, but it's now taking orders directly from the Treasury Department, not controlling the Treasury Department. And in that way, we can save the system from a chaotic collapse. This condition is generally spreading throughout the world. If you look at the rate of hyperinflation, right? Now there's one part of this hyperinflation which is of special significance, food. Now when you look at what happened yesterday in terms of the fraudulent operation run by Republicans and others in this primary election, yesterday. You say, what's the power that can defeat these predators, these imperialists, these parasites, these murderers, who are behind the use of the Democratic Party top down and other institutions and the press generally, used in trying to destroy the possibility of a Clinton presidency in the United States? That's your issue. Why? That is to eliminate the possibility of the United States being effective. Because what would happen? And where's this come into the food problem? Now, when people are denied this or that benefit, the lower 80% and many others will say, well, we've got to learn to put up with this. Can't we compromise? Isn't there some compromise that we can accept? Can't we get together and make a compromise? And you get a bunch of compromised people who just really aren't capable of doing anything useful. But food is different. If you don't have food tonight to put on the table in the morning, that's kind of personal. And it becomes universal. Now, for a number of months now, there has been a worldwide food crisis caused by many things, by the financial policies, various kind of management deals, by the WTO, which ought to be eliminated, by the promotion of biofuels, or biofuels, if you prefer, which is destroying food supplies. This biofuel program is a gigantic swindle for which there is no possible justification. None. The justification comes out of the World Wildlife Fund of Prince Philip, which says we must not have vampire bats offended by water projects. Exactly. You could get in Mexico, you could get, if you make a donation to the World Wildlife Fund of Prince Philip, you get a stuffed vampire bat with a handbook telling you what the wonderful properties of this vampire bat is, how it has this grooved tongue, which will cut through the skin. Its saliva will keep the blood from clotting. So the vampire bat can suck on you all day long. And we're supposed to regret the threat to the habits of this little bat. But the point is, here you have, for example, in northern Mexico, particularly in the vicinity of the province of Sonora, which is just below the border on the western side of Mexico. There, what do you have a large water system. If this water system is controlled, Mexico already has the engineering designs for a system which will enable Mexico to increase its total food production. Also, since we're throwing Mexicans out of the United States rapidly as possible in some cases, especially from areas like Los Angeles, where this does have a political effect on the community, there's no place for them to go. They could throw them across the border into that part of Mexico, which used to be an agricultural region, but the water's not there. When they left to become virtual slave labor in the United States, or cheap labor, before they got into construction jobs as virtually slave labor, they used to be farmers in areas like Sonora. The wives are not farmers. Mexican wives in that area are not developed as farmers. The husbands were the farmers, the husbands and the sons. So the agricultural product of this area has declined. There is a vast water system which, if organized, would permit us to open up large areas for agriculture so that people in Mexico already are being forced across the border back into Mexico, who happen to be farmers by tradition, would have the opportunity with some government cooperation from the Mexican government to begin opening this area for food production. When the World Food Organizations have indicated to us that the shortage of food production relative to human need is we are producing half the amount of food required for human need. And therefore, every place we can get food production going in a reasonable way, which usually requires irrigation projects, things like that, engineering projects, we have to. The estimate of experts is we need to double food production in order to meet the requirements of the human race. You have people like the Chancellor of Germany is complaining that Indians are causing a crisis in food supplies because they're eating two meals a day. And the report is that in many parts of Asia, the food consumption was, you were being getting meals, used to be three times a day, now it goes down to two, and now it goes down to one. The situation in Africa is beyond belief in terms of food supplies. What's in Zimbabwe, for example? What's the crime? You have an African population in Zimbabwe, which was one of the biggest fighters against the British Empire. It was called Southern Rhodesia one time. And this area is an area of people with a strong culture, strengthened by the fact they were fighters against the British imperialists. They're not allowed to develop their own territory because London, by various mechanisms, prevents them from doing so. And London uses the farms it allows to prosper in former Rhodesia to feed the populations of Britain. So you have non-African farmers running farms, producing food in Zimbabwe. For the edification and fattening of Brits. But the rest of the population is inhibited in any attempt to develop. You look through all of Africa and you look through the policies of NSM 200 back in 1975. The policy is that Africans should die out, not entirely, keep a few for this or that. But the policy is the raw materials of Africa belong to the Anglo-Americans. If the Africans develop and increase their population, they will use up some of those precious raw materials which belong to us. By what miracle, we don't know. Therefore, you must suppress them. And what do? You go down as they did with Kitson in Kenya. You start a war, which is organized by Kitson, his crowd personally, by MI5. Then they organize the countermeasures against the Mau Mau out of South Africa, the colonial operation. And they did a similar operation, which just run the recent election in Kenya, just recently. What's going on in Zimbabwe is the same thing. And this is the king we're up against. Let me go on the question of economics. Now, I'm an economist, and I can tell you I'm a good one, but there are very few competent economists in this planet. And the reason for that is, despite the fact we used to have an American system of political economy, which we understood fairly well, as opposed to the British economy, or the British system, as opposed to the so-called the free trade system, or the monetarist system. And under our system, as you some of you should know, is that our constitutional system states that money can be uttered, that is, issued, created, only by the U.S. federal government. No other agency has the right to create or control money, our money, except the Federal Reserve, our federal system. Now, the law stipulates that the authority of the executive branch to utter money or to utter credit which could be converted into money is a power of the presidency which lies with the consent of the House of Representatives. And therefore, it's a greenback policy. European systems, the imperial systems of Europe, do not have such a form. In the European system, the money is created by central bankers who are assemblies of private bank interests and some government mixed in there. So the central banking system protects the bankers against the intervention of the government, which means the people are not allowed to control their own money. Whereas under the US system, our federal system, the federal government has control of our money and protects it and protects us. So the purpose of the British system was to eliminate that. Now, you have people who come up with what's called a free trade system. And the problem is, as I said, we have very few competent economists. Now, theoretically, they're all incompetent. But some of them are not stupid. And therefore, they're essentially incompetent in defining what an economy is and how it works. But they're not stupid, and therefore they have a practical view of how to deal with this crazy thing called money. For example, back in my old days as a management consultant, we would have, in happier times then, you would have a conflict in most corporations, that is, in producer corporations, industrial corporations, for example, where you would have the department, which is a department of production, of design, of product making, and so forth. And these people would think in one way, but then you would have usually, especially as Wall Street became more powerful, the company would be controlled again by Wall Street, by the stockholders, these wonderful people called stockholders. They probably don't even know where the company is. And they've just bought into it yesterday, and they're going to sell the stock tomorrow. So these stockholders have a Wall Street interest, which comes in, as usually, some type of finance officer or so forth of the firm, and therefore the firm is operating on the one hand with a departments, which are the production and product design and so forth departments, which know what economics is, particularly under the old protection system we used to have years ago. Whereas the banking fund says, no, you run the corporations for the sake of the stockholders. And it's not just the stockholders of this corporation. What you operate from is a central banking function, like the Federal Reserve System, in which a concert of financial interests determines policy for a whole all types of firms in the U.S. economy and takes over control more and more of these firms. So therefore, the free trade system is a system which is based on what? It's based on the system of the ancient mercantile banker system, like the old Venetian systems, which concerts of private financial investors control the economy, and these powers in turn control the governments. What we're faced with today is exactly that. We're faced with a situation in which the United States government is controlled entirely by international financial interests, which are now centered in London. This occurred in the following way. When Nixon came into power, his administration, under the advice of George Shultz, caused the Bretton Woods system to be destroyed. That is, the United States went off the fixed exchange rate standard, the international fixed exchange rate system. In the following period, after these, a second operation was run. It was run from Europe. It was run by bankers associated with the Middle East petroleum production, including Saudi Arabia as part of the combination. These guys created in the 1970s a famous artificial shortage of petroleum, a freeze on the delivery of petroleum. So you had tankers full of petroleum floating off the coast, moored off the coast of the United States and other places, but especially the United States. And there was we had an oil shortage. We had a wild increase in prices of petroleum. Out of this, what had happened is the United States had lost the power to control its own currency, the dollar, under the Federal Reserve System, and now the power to control the price of the dollar was being determined by what was called the oil cartel, the Amsterdam-based spot market oil cartel. So we no longer controlled our own currency. More and more, from that point on, under Nixon, and under the programs of the Rockefeller brothers during that period, we destroyed every bit of the essential structure of our economy as it came out of the Great Depression under Roosevelt's leadership. You go back further and look at the fight. The fight was, first of all, the United States against Britain, was a fight for our freedom and a fight for the fight against the efforts of the British to destroy us in various ways. Like, for example, the British, who controlled international slavery during the 19th century through their Spanish suckers. The Spanish monarchy was a tool of the British monarchy in running the slave system. The spread of slavery in the United States was run by the British through the Spanish, who were their puppets. Part of the proper operation was not merely the slave system. Part of the operation was to destroy the United States by dividing it between non-slave states and slave states, which Lincoln defeated. Lincoln's defeat of this operation resulted in a development of the United States as a sovereign continental power, from the Atlantic to the Pacific, from the Canadian border to the Mexican border. We were developed largely by immigration. We were developed by the development of agriculture. The whole development was based on developing an international, or national, in this case, national railway grid, our continental railway system. Right? As a result of this, and a result of the power we represented coming out of Lincoln's war against the British, called the Confederacy, the United States became a threat to the British Empire through the fact that Russia, from 1876 on, Germany, from 1879 approximately on, and other states began to develop continental railway systems and develop other modes of technology proved in the United States for developing inland land territory. This became known the issue of geopolitics. Maritime power, control of the continent from the seas, or the inland power of nations which we developed the management of their own internal territory, geopolitics. And as a result of that, there was a beginning 1890 with the firing of Bismarck from the position of Chancellor in Germany. There was a process launched by the British which became known as World War I, which actually started with the British organizing Japan for an attack, war on China, which continued in effect from 1895 to 1945, and similar wars in that region. So what Roosevelt represented then as president was the effort to restore the balance that we had lost in previous struggles, to restore the United States to what it had been. We succeeded. The British put Hitler into power. The British put Mussolini into power. The British organized World War I and World War II, both of them. But the British got into a mess in the process, and they decided to come over to the side of Roosevelt conditionally, or some of them did. And therefore, we fought a war against Hitler and so forth, but it was actually a war with the British. But it was partly an alliance with the British, who cooperated with us for the purpose of defeating Hitler. But the minute that Roosevelt was dead, even before Roosevelt was dead, in the latter part of 1944, what happened is, again, the Wall Street crowd under Truman took over, and we went back in the direction of becoming British. We retained that power, our power that Roosevelt gave us, up until 1963, until the immediate aftermath of the assassination of President Kennedy. We were fooled into going into a war in Indochina. This war in Indochina drew us down, and thus, with the explosion of the 68ers in Europe and in the United States and elsewhere in 1968, you had the break between the blue-collar classes of people in the United States, for example, and these baby boomers who were rioting in the streets, were actually mostly pro-fascist. And that split the Democratic Party, shattered the good side of the Republican Party, and gave us the situation we have today. Therefore, the question before us is, what do we do about this? We have to recognize, and this comes to the part of my other two proposals of that time, which last year, which are subsequently published. Not only a two-tier credit system, that is 1 to 2% for government-approved kinds of credit, and floating rates on interest for other things. And secondly, that the United States, under its next or current president or next president in point of fact, should go to Russia, China, and India and propose that these countries combine as a core group of countries to bring other nations together in a new Bretton Woods conference to reestablish a fixed exchange rate system, which would be guaranteed by the sovereign agreement of these nations. Thus, to go back to the Roosevelt system, to put the international monetary financial system, which is hopelessly bankrupt, into bankruptcy reorganization, and thus start to rebuild. This is what the issue is, and this is the danger from the standpoint of London. They're now moving
on the consolidation of power by this financial interest in the United States, in Western and Central Europe, and elsewhere, and this power to conduct effective warfare, including killing warfare,
by military means against Russia, China, India, and other countries. This is what the game is. And if this game is not stopped, I can tell you there'll be no planet. But then come back to the food question. If you want to get the American people and other people of other nations up on their hind legs, acting like free people rather than battered slaves, tell them their food for next tomorrow morning is not there. That activates popular resistance more than anything else. We are now in such a situation. For many parts of the world, the lack of food is an immediate reality. There is a growing explosion throughout much of the world over this food shortage issue. My wife, Helga, is involved in Europe and is spreading here as an effort. Around the meeting of the FAO That's the International Food Organization in Rome in June. And to mobilize people of the world around this question of food is production, distribution, supply. This comes in direct collision with the World Trade Organization, which is virtually a fascist organization. It comes in conflict with the British policies of Prince Philip, for example, who is, with his bats, is opposed to developing water systems in Sonora region. And these, therefore, you are now at the same time that you have, people have orchestrated this last phase of this election in the United States, in Indiana and in North Carolina, have orchestrated a coup d'etat against the U.S. constitutional system. That's what it is, in fact. This is treason. What happened yesterday is treason, because its intention was treasonous, not because the act itself was anything more than a crime, but the intention was treasonous. Therefore, it's treason. And the enemy of this treat, the enemy of the United States, is thus those who are taking the food away from the people of the United States as of other countries. This thing is building up. It's recognized internationally. Most countries are already facing this crisis. The rate of food shortage is increasing because the stocking from various food stores, annual stores, has been already delivered, and there's not enough. So as the fact of the empty warehouses and equivalent forms of suppliers, as these things go down without food, the food crisis is going to accelerate. And you're going to have not only other parts of the world, but also American citizens who are now faced with the threat of death by food shortages. The time has come that those who are trying to gloat over the fakery they pulled yesterday has come to an end, because a hungry people will be a revolting people. And those who set forth this conflict will have to reap the harvest. Therefore, we must not be pessimistic about what's happening in this last phase of the election. It's a fraud. The fraud with the present powers will make it stick, because that's what they do. They're fakers. The whole thing is a fraud. They don't want Obama. They just want to use him to destroy Hillary Clinton. That's all. Once they destroy Hillary Clinton, they'll get rid of Obama. That's their intention. And their intention is to bring in a fascist regime in the United States, a presidency which will be, in effect, a fascist regime, which will cooperate with the British and bring the United States into alliance with the United Kingdom, or the Anglo-Dutch liberals. Not all Brits are for this, by the way, and even some influential ones. But and with a Europe, or Western and Central Europe, taken over by this same imperial power. An imperial power whose intention is to go to war against Russia, China, India, and other countries using nuclear power. That's the intention. So therefore, the issue here is not the election result. The issue is not the president. Obama's not competent to be a president. He has none of the makings of competence. Many of his constituencies are valuable people who are tied to the interests of the lower 80%, and they should be encouraged and defended, and their rights defended. Obama's a failure. He's sort of an Elmer Gantry of politics. It's the best way to characterize him. And thus, we're now in a point where a revolutionary movement, or the makings of it, is building up around the food issue. And therefore, those who triumphed yesterday are not going to continue to triumph for long. The result is either we win and restore the kind of government we require in various nations and among nations, or this world is going to go into hell, because the crisis won't quit. The people will die of hunger. They will die in increasing numbers. They will kill for food. The structure of society will be destroyed in the fight over food, which is not there. Therefore, either we win this fight against this evil, or there won't be anything to fight for. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. Before we get to our question and answer period, let me just say a couple of things. One is just to remind people and to tell people who have not participated in one of these events before. We have a number of questions that have been submitted by various institutions here in Washington and around the nation. We are taking questions via the internet. And of course, we will take questions from those of you who are here in the audience. If you have a question, members of our staff have index cards for you. I would ask that you put down your name, your affiliation. If you want me to read your question, please write it out. If you wish to ask the question yourself, please indicate that, but also do indicate the nature of your question, since we're trying to organize the questions in some coherent way. Otherwise, I would encourage people who are here, people who are listening over the internet, to please make sure that they have in their possession Mr. LaRouche's two latest works. One is a pamphlet that was just released by LPAC, which is Mr. LaRouche's interim report on the elections. This was composed just prior to the Pennsylvania primary. Also, what you will find on the website, both of LPAC and also of Executive Intelligence Review, is Mr. LaRouche's latest piece called H.G. Wells's Mein Kampf, Sir Cedric Cesspool's Empire. Something which I think people will find very useful, especially in light of Mr. LaRouche's remarks here today. Now, in getting to the questions that we have, as I said, I will try to intersperse questions from the audience with some of the institutional questions. I'd also like to just take a moment to ask you to join me in extending our most heartfelt sympathy to a great friend of Mr. LaRouche and of the LaRouche movement, and certainly a great friend to the citizens of Washington, D.C. Dr. Abdul Ali Mohammed, who all of you know, lost his wife this past weekend. She also was a great friend. She was by his side in the Abundant Life Clinic and in the fight to save D.C. General Hospital. She will be sorely missed, and I know that all of you will join me in extending sympathy and condolences to Dr. Mohammed. Okay. Lynn, we have a communication that was sent in by Tom Jackson from the Alabama House of Representatives. Representative Jackson is the chairman of the Alabama House Committee on Agriculture and Forestry and is the vice chair of the House Democratic Caucus. He also is the former chair of the Agricultural Committee of the National Black Caucus of State Legislators. He was part of a Schiller Institute delegation that visited Sudan in the 1990s, and he is also the principal sponsor of the HBPA in the state of Alabama, which just recently passed the Alabama House. He says, "Dear Lynn, I agree wholeheartedly with your initiative to once and for all stop all of the free trade policies and to return to the principle of parity pricing for our farmers. Like you, I'm very concerned with the ongoing destruction of our food supply and the increasing hunger and starvation among our people. Hunger haunts the planet, both here and abroad. I've witnessed this crime not only in the states that I have been privileged to visit, but also on the great continent of Africa, where I saw the impact that it can have on other populations. but also the possibility of doing something to change the outcome. Our legislature in Alabama is in session this spring for only several more days, so I have taken the liberty of drafting a short resolution addressing this crisis, which hopefully I will be able to introduce into the Alabama House. I've enclosed the resolution for use at your meeting in Washington. Good luck on your effort to halt the spread of hunger and want before it overruns our planet. I also would call on legislators from around the nation to join me in introducing similar resolutions. Representative Jackson's resolution is a long one. Rather than take the time to read it here, what I would simply indicate for you is that the resolution is an expression of precisely what Helga Zepp-LaRouche has called for in terms of addressing this question of the global food supply. We will put a copy of Representative Jackson's resolution up on the LaRouche PAC site. And again, we as well would encourage other leaders across the United States to act similarly. Lynn, the first question comes from someone who is working in one of the presidential campaigns, and what she says is. She says, Mr. LaRouche, forgive me for this. I feel like I'm bringing down the level of discussion. But the fact is that some of us have no choice but to deal with the day-to-day reality of electoral politics. The one statistic that is reported over and over again by everyone, and which is not disputed anywhere, is that 90% of the Democrats, and I do emphasize Democrats, who voted for Barack Obama in each of the past primaries have said that they would indeed vote for Hillary Clinton in a McCain versus Hillary race. However, the opposite is simply not true. The majority of those who vote for Hillary now may indeed vote for McCain in a McCain versus Obama race. This is not my estimate. This is what these polls are showing. My question, therefore, is what is up with the Democratic Party? The DNC, the House Democratic Caucus, the Senate Democratic Caucus, even from the most limited, pragmatic, pedestrian view, the simple fact is that Hillary can beat John McCain and Barack Obama cannot. What are they doing? Do they know what they're doing, or are they being played for fools?
In some sense, they're being played for fools. But the problem is with them is not misinformation. It's a systemic moral problem. You have to realize that what happened after 1968, particularly with what happened in the 1970s, for example, as a consequence of Nixon, is that the baby boomer generation is not simply a generation. It's not an age group of people born between 1945 and 1958. But rather, there's a certain element in it, a composition to it. You have a blue-collar and similar type of layer. You have proud engineers and so forth. But then you have, specifically in this age group, the so-called white-collar group, and sometimes it was a very dirty collar, white-collar, which is the typical roving fascists of 1968, both in the United States and in various countries in Europe, and South America and elsewhere. So what happens is these fellows, what do they stand for? They represent anti-technology. This was the hardcore of the 1970s, kill nuclear power, support destruction of the agriculture on so-called environmentalist grounds. One thing after the other. The systemic destruction of the United States was based on the impact of the rise of the 68ers throughout the political institutions during the 1970s. Now what happened is then you have another section of the white collar baby boomer generation who were not pigs, unlike Obama's friends from Chicago. Well, but what happened is they found themselves, who were actually had some competence, some knowledge, some dedication to sanity. They probably changed their underwear, as Al Gore, I understand, does not. But they found themselves in an inferior position of political influence. So what happened is the scumbags, to use a nice term, rose to the top positions. You'll find all kinds of people. You look at their pedigree. Hey, these guys are really filthy. They're not unwashed. They rub in dirt to make sure they are unwashed. They're pot-headed. All these wonderful qualities. And here you have the other baby boomer who went to a university, perhaps, or has some pride, thought of maintaining a normal family life, finds that his or her conditions of life are not really improving that much, and sometimes getting worse. Whereas the scumbags, to use a euphemism, are prospering. They're at the top positions. So what you have with not only with the elected officials who are of this category, or government officials who have this background, but you have a whole coterie of people around them, like political groups, action groups, this kind of thing, which are the political machine. And the political machine is dominated by people you wouldn't want your daughter to marry. But you have to respect them because they have the money and the power. As a result of this, the Democratic Party, but you have the same thing in the Republican Party, it takes sometimes a different form. So you have this generation of boomers who have either were part of the scum and who are in power, often in top-ranking power. Not the very top often, but top-ranking. And then you have the other boomers of the same white-collar background who had some competence, but they're the discouraged. They gave up. Over the course of the 1980s, they gave up trying to fight against the boomers in power. You know, it's like, you know, in warfare, generally, soldiers have to retire from combat or related duties at the age of 35, approximately, because they're no longer in combat condition. And the same thing is true of boomers. They reach the age of 35, their sex life is drying out from overuse. And similar kinds of things. And they are no longer fighters. And their values change. And I've observed this even in my own organization. The change that occurs. Those who once fought are now looking for comfort zones, not foxholes. So therefore, they adapt to being, well, we can't fight them. We have to learn to somehow make our traditions felt in some way. But we have to accept the terms that they demand that we accept. And therefore, what you've got then is a revolutionary potential. Because these boomers have no regard for the actual well-being of people in the lower 80% of family income brackets. Therefore, if you want to organize a political movement in the United States, as Hillary has demonstrated with her own campaign fairly well, with what she's done since the New Hampshire campaign, if you want to organize a political base, don't look to your boomers. I mean, she's the same age as Helga, right? 60. Hillary and Helga are the same age. And they have a similar kind of situation. I think Helga's better at it, but that's all right. As a matter of fact, I know she's better at it. But Hillary has done a fine job in her own way. But they find themselves with condition to dependency upon the boomer generation, which is now ensconced in many of the political positions which determine politics. Their instinct is boomer. It's not their brains, because brains are not too good condition these days. They get aged out after the age of 36 when the sex began to dry up. So therefore, the problem of the Clintons, as of many other politicians, is they are depending too much on the boomers who are the layer they go to for political support in political institutions and similar kinds of institutions. They're also key for fundraising. So therefore, you have a money problem involved here. So the only solution for this, which is typical of history, you want to fight a war, don't concentrate on the old age homes. You want to fight a war, get people under 35 years of age. You want to fight a war, get some good generals, of course, good strategists, and so forth, but you need the people who have the energy to understand the mission, who will accept the training, who have the sense of the vim and vigor, are between 18 and 35. Those are your fighting troops. These people, obviously, since you're looking for numbers, you're going to the most numerous part of 18 to 35. And these people are generally middle class or lower income groups or poor. And therefore, if you're looking for success, choose the right constituency. If you want a victory, choose the right army. Yes, you need a few generals, but they have to have the right army. And the army has to be well-informed. It has to understand its mission. It has to have some tactical sense of what it's doing. And it has to be dedicated with a mission orientation. Now you have, all over the world, people who are fighting a life and death struggle for food. Food which is being taken away from them, denied to them. Organize the lower 80% of the population for a war for food, because the alternative is mass death through starvation and disease. And if Prince Philip has his way in his opposition to any development of the water systems in the Plano system with his bats, his vampire bats, you don't have a chance. Humanity doesn't have a chance. See, you don't go to war unless there's no other alternative. And you don't go to war for the purpose of continuing war. You go to war for the sense of trying to win the opposition into acceding to terms that you negotiate with them. Which means that we have the wrong philosophy these days. We have a philosophy of trying to find out what nation is our enemy. Is it China? Oh, 1.4 billion people, perhaps more, you know. That's a lot of people. Maybe we should cut down the number, huh? Indian, 1.1 billion people. Oh, that's much too much. It was much better when there were only 300 million of them. And so forth and so on. Africa, well, we're not going to fight that. We just reduce the population. That's what the policy is now. That is it. And therefore, someone saying they're going to fight for black, they better not get too involved with Obama's leadership. Maybe some of the Obama leaders, his faction leaders, are very useful people, very important people. The base is important, the lower 80%, family income brackets. They don't have any interest in this crap. They may be sucked into something. I just go to one other thing on this African-American question. You have in two leading tendencies in the United States among people of African descent. One sense is a great man, my type of fighter, from famous for the Washington, D.C. area, in point of fact. And he was replaced in influence during the course of the 20th century, under the influence of Jim Crow and other things, by an idea of don't go out there and fight and originate, but wait for good things to descend upon you. Now, in terms of the African-American constituent, see, of the Obama campaign, you've got to look carefully at this. You have the fighter who fought to get free of slavery, who probably killed to be free of slavery, and who also was a great thinker, a scientist, a musician, whose sons were musicians and scientists, who was a leader, like many others who fought the fight against slavery in the United States. They didn't wait for something to descend upon them from above. They didn't wait for a little good thing to drip down on them. Their son was to go out and fight for it. Not just fight for it, but make it, build it. And what happened is it conditioned the population of the United States with the destruction of industry, because the strength, largely, of the African-American population in former times was largely in industry. The real strength of the African-American in the United States was based on industry and also technology and science, even though it was a small number, relatively speaking. The association with high degrees of skill, the association with rising from low level of skill to a higher level of skill in one's lifetime, and a higher position in life, and a better life for one's children. Make it happen. Don't wait for it to descend upon you. Make it happen. Huh? And the problem is, look at Obama. Obama says nothing. The problem does not lie with the people around him. The people around us, we know many of the leaders in the Obama campaign, they're good people. They think like that. They're fighters. They're in it for various reasons. But the thing is, get the image. We're going to make it happen. We're going to make it happen. How? What's your program, Obama? There is none. What are you going to do to cure the problem? You have nothing to offer. But why would somebody vote for Obama who promises everything but promises not to deliver it? By unction, like Elmer Gantry. You know, this traveling salesman in the novel. There was this movie with Burt Lancaster. It was a kind of funny movie, good movie. Very good. It was a very good job. And you get this religious preacher, a faker, like the fundamentalists, like the Jerry Falwell types. And they come along and say, look, Jesus will save you. I'm going to, you know, we're going to have raise this money tonight. We're going to do this. Jesus is going to save you if you do this. It's going to descend upon you. Yeah? Whereas in the Christian view, which that is not a Christian view, but the Christian view is, well, find in oneself the strength to do what has to be done. Spend your life for something useful. Make something necessary happen. Discover what your mission is and do it. Build something, make something. And you've got these people out there voting for Obama who in many cases are waiting for it to descend upon them. He promises the revolution. He promises the great change. Where is it coming from? If it's going to be a great change, you're going to do something, aren't you? What are you going to do? What are you going to do, Obama? Huh? You haven't done anything so far. You're taking a lot of money, but what have you done? You haven't done anything. What are the problems of life of people out there? What have you done about these problems? What have you done about the housing crisis? What have you done about the education problem? What have you done about the health care problem? You've done nothing. You've talked about everything. Like Elmer Gantry, the great swindler. Like the minister who creates more people behind the curtain than he Rousseau's in front. That's what it is, Elmer Gantry. And the problem here is not the fact that he does that. That's bad. The problem is the people put up with it. Here they are, they think they want revolutions. They want salvation. They want the good to descend upon. They're waiting for the great faith-based initiative money coming down upon them. And if faith-based initiative will bring that great flow of money down upon them, then they will get all the sex and other blessings they desire. Elmer Gantry style. And that's fakery. But the problem is, why do the American people put up with it? And I can tell you why, from my experience, even from 2004. Faith-based initiative. People came to us who had been leaders that we'd worked with for years in the civil rights movement. They say, yeah, you're good, you're right, but you don't have the money, and we need the money. And so they drifted off from being against, from being fighters to make it happen, to being quite the contrary. Give me the money. Give me the money. Let it descend upon us. Let that great shower of money from the sky descend upon us. And that's the Obama campaign, Alma Gantry. See the movie. It's all there for you. And we had a whole, by the destruction of industry, by the destruction of the kinds of things that transform a poor people, poorly educated, poorly treated, into people who make things happen in a factory, in a machine shop, in whatever. Make it happen. Don't pray for it. Make it happen. Pray for the strength of your arm to do it and nothing else. Pray for the strength of your brain to see it and to accomplish it. Feel the joy and dignity of being something. We used to say, you know, in the civil rights struggle, be somebody, be somebody, be somebody who makes things happen. Not this slouch. It's going to descend upon us. Anyway, that's the problem. And we have to, in reaching out to these people who are in the Obama organizations, we have to tell them this. Cut it out. Stop the fakery. Get real. Make it happen. People are starving for lack of food. Make it happen. People are starving for lack of decent jobs. Make it happen. People are starving for lack of infrastructure. Make it happen. People are starving for lack and dying for lack of health care. Make it happen. Be a doctor. Make it happen. Create the situation which you can become a physician or your friend can become one. Make it happen. Don't tell me about what's going to descend upon us, because by some unction you're going to draw, suck this thing down from the sky upon you. Make it happen.
Okay, the next question was submitted by a gentleman who holds statewide office in New York. He says, Mr. LaRouche, the New York press is full of stories that Karl Rove has insinuated that the Republicans are in possession of an October surprise to be used if Barack Obama becomes the Democratic nominee. But that would indicate that it would be their intention to make John McCain president. And that doesn't seem to make sense to me. Personally, I do think John McCain is crazy, but I really don't believe that he is a fascist. What is your view of this?
I think that what I've seen, and clinical things that I've actually seen, John McCain is a troubled mind. And he's not. You know, the point is, you look at him, as I define this situation with him, McCain, only positive factor is not in himself, as I said. Anything positive McCain comes from his family. It comes from the Navy tradition that he represents through his father and so forth. Now, you had a certain section of the Navy tradition. You had two to one. One was British. And that's the Pearl Harbor problem. The other side was with MacArthur in the same relevant period. And that tradition understood one thing. See, the important thing to say, we are in this room, or in this United States. The important thing to say, we are Americans. Now, let me just divert from in the answer to the question to get this thing in here, because I think it's important. We came out of a dark age in Europe, a result of the kind of economic policies which are represented by the people in London, by the people who support these policies in Wall Street and elsewhere today. We came out of that, out of a dark age. And one of the great leaders was a fellow who became a cardinal of the Catholic Church, Cardinal Nicholas of Cusa. Cusa had two great accomplishments in life, or to sum it up as to what the summation was. One was his Concordancia Cattolica, which was essentially a statement of the intention of Dante Alighieri in Demonarchia. That is the formation of the nation state as opposed to imperial systems. This, in the case of Cusa, was placed in a different way. It was based on Christian doctrine. And it was a solution for the Dark Age situation. It was a key part with the councils leading into the formation of the modern nation state in Europe. Cusa. Cusa was also a great scientist who discovered or rediscovered the principles of physical science. And all competent modern European science flows directly through Cusa from precedents which he himself studied in terms of the ancient Greeks, the Pythagoreans, and Plato, and so forth. So European civilization is a product of this mobilization around Cusa, with people also like Brunelleschi, who discovered the principle of the catenary before anybody else seemed to have done. It's called the funicula in Italian. Funiculi, funicula. So anyway, so this is our civilization. Now, our civilization was corrupted, but the same way it's corrupted now, because of an oligarchical, financier oligarchical power. Now, under these conditions, Cusa, after some defeats and wars against these powers, prescribed a policy. Let us in Europe, he said, in effect, to summarize it, let us go to other parts of the world across the oceans. Let us meet the people in other parts of the world from around the oceans. Now, let us work with them and let us give them the best of us. So that together with them, we shall build something that will surround the sickness inside Europe and solve the problem. So Cusa died, but a young Genoese sea captain in the Portuguese service found the documents of Cusa's will and testament on this point. And this resulted in, particularly, in the exploration by Christopher Columbus to discover America. This was not Christopher Columbus's discovery. This was the discovery made by Cusa. Now, since that point, the problem was Europe had European civilization, which in its culture was very good, especially as revived by the Renaissance. The problem was the oligarchy of Europe was still successfully controlling it. And therefore, the purpose was to move the best of European civilization across the ocean to settlements in other continents, and thus to create a European civilization heritage which would not be enslaved by European oligarchical traditions. So therefore, one of the movements which my ancestors in this country came out of was that. My ancestors' relevance came in this country back in the first half of the 17th century, the first real settlements in New England and so forth of that period. And so what we brought into the United States, what became the United States, was the best of European culture without those damn oligarchs. But they chased us over and they came after us and made a mess of things. So the United States is specifically a product of that Cusa connection, that Cusa nexus. We are an expression primarily of European civilization in root at the best, in our devotion, our dedication, our conception of man. We are superior morally to Europeans generally on this issue. We don't believe in oligarchies. We don't believe in kissing the butt of some prince this or count that. We think they're all no counts. But anyway, but therefore what we have represented is the planting of the best distillation of European culture, largely through the immigrants from Europe who came here, not to flee Europe as such, but to find an opportunity to build a better world. This is our national character. This is we at our best. And that's the issue today. That's the way we have to think about things. We have a mission Our mission is to take the best of European culture and what it's been able to draw into our society, and to use that as a weapon on behalf of the improvement of all mankind, the liberation of mankind from oligarchism, for example. That's our mission. That's what we should be doing. That's our immortality as a nation. But we, therefore, are an enemy and a target of the European oligarchy, which hates our guts and always has. And therefore, they try to corrupt us and destroy us. They're now moving to try to destroy us. And I say, gentlemen, if my wit and arm have any strength in it, we're going to destroy you. Because the world has had too much of you oligarchs, including the British oligarchs. And I'm going to encourage people like both the Clintons and their real supporters, the sincere ones as opposed to the Johnny-come-latelys, and also the people from the Obama camp who care about this country and care about the human race and are willing to join me on the issue of let's do it rather than wait for it to descend upon us. Let's take it. It's ours. And let's take it. Let's feed our people. And that's what the issue has to be. We have to have a war, which is a war to defend the American tradition as expressed by Roosevelt in his presidency and by other great figures of our society, some in high places, some not, but have all contributed to this intention, which some of us, like me, we have in our bones. This is what we believe. We believe in that kind of mission. We believe in taking the best of European civilization and combining it with the best we find from other parts of the world and combine it into a force for a society free of oligarchism, free of a situation which some people own other people or subject them to conditions which are virtually owning them. To say that the hungry must be fed. And we have to go to this as to war, not to kill, but to win the war. And if we don't do it now, it will come many generations down the line before you'll have the opportunity to see civilization again.
Hey, Lynn, the next question comes from a former Secretary of Labor. And she says, Mr. LaRouche, one of the most pressing issues we face right now is the price of fuel. On the food issue, clearly one way to address this problem is to increase food production. However, the massive increases in the price of fuel are not a result of oil shortages per se. Hillary Clinton's proposal at least recognizes the problem, but we're all aware of the fact that it hardly solves it. My question to you is, what action would you recommend? Is the proper path one of going after OPEC and the big oil companies? Is there some legislative initiative that should be pursued? But clearly this issue does have to be addressed.
She's right, you have to be addressed. But let's say, what is it we have to do to address this problem? First of all, we have to recognize that the problems we have, because remember, the idea of food for peace and so forth was a characteristic of the Franklin Roosevelt administration. It was not original to them, but it was characteristic of it. So why do we have it today? We had developed a food-producing policy for the world, which worked. Why did we abandon it? Because the oligarchs took over. Now, what happened is, therefore, the habit of not raising food, and I'll be specific on this because it's important that I do be specific, of not raising food is one imposed from London and other papers. But London, the British, not the British people, because most of them are, it's specifically this dirty crowd, this Anglo-Dutch liberal financier interests, the parasites, the legacy of Venice, the bloodsuckers, the usurers of the planet, and the solar system if they could get it. So therefore, this is the enemy. If you are not prepared to destroy that enemy, any measure you're proposed won't work. Roosevelt showed, the Roosevelt administration showed we could do it. The technology exists. It's a matter of technology and will. Do it. But We say, we've got to work within the parameters of what the consent of these people. No, they don't have any rights. They're behaving as inhuman people. They don't have any rights for their principle. They are criminals. We don't propose to execute them. They're not edible, after all. But that's the situation. Therefore, we have to take the power. You have to say, don't try to say how to solve this problem or that problem. You have to go at the gut of the thing. If you say, let's go back to Franklin Roosevelt, that is a very good way of identifying it. If Roosevelt did it, it was good. If somebody doesn't like Roosevelt, he's no good. That should be your base in politics, and go at it that way. Then you don't have a problem. The basic thing is simple. We can, with programs, we can double food production on this planet. That is not really an impossible task. But you have to have the institutions and the political will and the political control to do it. Therefore, you have to take political power. You have to be, again, like the Obama question. Don't wait for it to descend upon you. Don't say, what shall we put in our prayers to be dropped on us tonight? No. You say, what are we going to do to change the system so that it happens? Same thing. And it's not a technical problem. This has been worked on before. All the records are there. How we do it is known. No problem. The problem is the system. But the problem is not how to change the system. The problem is how to eliminate it. We had a system before that worked. Go back to it.
And for those of you who are listening via the World Wide Web, you're listening to a live seminar from Washington, D.C. Our principal speaker is Mr. Lyndon LaRouche. All right, Lynn, the next question is from somebody who has a big personal stake, I suppose, in asking it. He says, Mr. LaRouche, if you were running Hillary Clinton's presidential campaign, knowing her and her capabilities, i.e., not if you were a candidate yourself, but if you were advising Hillary, what would you tell her? How can she intensify her appeal to the lower 80%? Do you think that any of this ultimately is sufficient to overcome the hierarchy that's determined to keep her out of the presidency? And if not, then what do you think she has to add to her appeal?
Well, we have to have, if you want to deal with that problem, you have to be prepared to declare war. And you have to, you know, it's often, it's like the Gideon's army problem. I think that, you know, if Hillary is not acquainted with Gideon's army, I'm sure Bill has a long lecture he can give her on that subject, the biblical lecture on Gideon's army. That you have to go out, you find a bunch of people around you who you know you can't trust. You have a campaign organization of people around you you know you can't trust. They're prepared to skedaddle and go to the opposite camp at the first chance, the first opportunity. That's your problem. So therefore, what you have to do is do two things, one of which Hillary is already doing. Hillary has gone repeatedly to the lower 80%. Therefore, on this issue, she has credibility with most of the, all of the best of the Obama people, supporters, as well as the citizens generally. That's number one. Now, you have to think like Franklin Roosevelt. You have to build the team that is going to do the job. What I see in her situation from a distance, because I'm not on the inside of it, therefore I will limit what I think I can say about it, because I'm not an insider to it, is that she's doing too much of too little with too little. That she's relying upon people who she doesn't have to throw them away, but in general, obviously, she doesn't have the team she needs. She may have a few people, a few collaborators who are doing a good job. She may have others who are doing what they're told while they continue to be attached. But she doesn't have, as I wrote in this on the election problem, She needs a team. You need a government, not a personality. Yes, you need a personality, but you need a government. And you've got to go in on a fight like this, like a government, with your full panoply of government, of a U.S.-style presidential government. And that should be your campaign team. And you go in like a machine, and you fight the way I fight. You know, some people think that I'm in trouble, I'm not as competent. Well, it's not that I'm not lack, it's I have too much competence. And therefore the enemy wanted to get me out of the way quick. So, and they tried a couple of times. But what you need is what I represent, the same kind of thing. You've got to have a team of people who say, let's make it happen. But it has to be a team which is like a machine, which is able to go in and gobble up anything that gets in the way. A juggernaut. And the problem is, I think, that she's traded, not because of her choice, but because of circumstances, has been traded from a juggernaut, which she actually needs, or what she's trying, to herself and a few other people working with a bunch of people who may be semi-willing collaborators, and also sabotaging things they don't like.
Trying to do this in order of people's position, so to speak. This is from the Senate, the Democratic side anyway, of the Senate Agricultural Committee. Mr. LaRouche, will you be drafting something similar to the HBPA on the food question? Regardless of whether you plan on submitting actual legislation, what specifically would you recommend in the way of legislative action to immediately address the crisis?
Again, I think you've got to go hit it on the flank first. Don't think about a piece of legislative action first. What we have now is we have an upcoming Rome conference of the FAO. The original intention of the Rome conference was not good. The FAO was a good idea. It was done by an American of Jewish author, paradigm, and so on, who became a very significant influence in the United States and who went to Rome and got Alexander III to adopt this thing, and so that's how it was founded in Rome. But there is this conference now, and the original intention was to promote a usual nonsense type of trend toward a destruction of everything. But because of the importance of the issue, remember you've got governments, powerful institutions in government throughout Europe and other parts of the world who today want this reform, who are fighting for food reform. And the problem here in the United States is someone thinks that if the newspapers here don't put out food as the issue, they think it's not an issue. Well, for hungry people, it's an issue. They don't need to read the New York Times to discover whether or not it's an issue. If they didn't get their dinner last night, if their family hasn't been fed, that gets the message across quite nicely. Particularly when they see the prices of food going up, again, which is a swindle. So therefore, the key thing is to take an international fulcrum and make, the way you make good legislation.
Good legislation is you
get out there and it becomes a power in its own right by mobilizing around it. Now, food attracts a lot of attention. The lack of food attracts even more attention. And therefore, the lack of food is working for you. So what you have to do is say, we must cancel these programs. We must cancel the WTO. We must cancel the Food for Fuel program. And nobody denied that Food for Fuel is a complete fraud. And it's genocidal in its implications. The Food for Fuel program is one of the major factors causing starvation today. Which means death. It's a murderer. And the Food for Fuel program should be killed right now. I don't care whether the president of Brazil likes that or not. It's going to be killed, as far as I'm concerned, now. We're going to double the food production, because if we don't double food production, we're not going to have a stable supply of food, because you have to realize, not only do we have a food shortage, We have a food shortage in terms of absolute numbers. We have a food shortage in the sense that people who used to have three meals a day went down from two and are headed toward one or none. Therefore, what you have to do is destroy the existing institutions that are part of this policy that did this, such as the WTO, such as food for fuel policy. That policy must be destroyed. Now, your program flows from that, because the minute you say that, we have on the record, for example, the Nehru Green Revolution policy for India. We have all these records. We have the thing in centered out of the Philippines. Vast programs exist for meeting food requirements. And we are short of some of the skilled people we need for this, but we can get the job going. So you need simply the obvious enabling legislation, which states its purpose simply, you know, a three-page report, no longer than three pages, which states what the policy is and indicates what the objectives are to be reached. Then you put that out as policy, you destroy and nullify any policy that contradicts that, then you go back in the manuals and you dig out all the things that are there which are worthwhile, get a committee working, and piece the thing together for an action program now, and it works. That's the way to do it. See, the hesitation is trying to get into something that you put it through the normal legislative process. I wouldn't give you 2 cents for the whole damn Congress right now. There are about several people in it. You want the people who are kissing the butt of Nancy Pelosi to draft your legislation for you? Or to pass it? Anything she passes, I don't want to get near. Like Al Gore, you know. So the point is, don't try to find recipes that you hope you can sell on. Because in this case, you're fighting a war. And the war is, are you going to have biofuels? If you are, you're not serious. Cancel biofuels. Immediately. Biofuels is a swindle. The possibility of marketing them as competing with other fuels is entirely a government-paid swindle, and a people-paid swindle. It's a swindle. So cancel the swindle. Tell them no more subsidy, buddy. No more international subsidy, no WTO caps and so forth. Cut it out and watch the food for fuel program die. And watch the farmers scamper back to producing food for food.
Mr. LaRouche, I'm going to put you on the spot with this one, Lynn. Mr. LaRouche, I have been following you and your organization for quite some time, and I must say that I agree with much of what you say. During the course of the Pennsylvania primary, both my wife and I and several of our friends took leaves of absence from work to go up to Pennsylvania to volunteer for Hillary Clinton. If Obama is a fall guy set up by the British Empire, and obviously the election is one of the most important parts of fixing the US economy, then my question to you, and I don't ask you this sarcastically, but with all sincerity, why are you not backing Hillary Clinton 100%? I understand that she is not perfect, but is without doubt the only one that has a chance of doing right by humanity. Also, taking into consideration her using so many of your policies as talking points, as well as repeatedly invoking the name of Franklin Delano Roosevelt on the campaign trail, I really do believe that she will embrace your economic change with open arms if she wins the nomination and the presidency. Shouldn't we have everyone, including most especially you, endorse her and help push her for the nomination, since this election is so very important?
Just think again about that. Think about that formulation. Think what's wrong with it. Well, first of all, as I've said repeatedly, as the head of a PAC, it is contrary to law for me to endorse her. And it's certainly that interpretation we put on it if I did it. So I didn't do it. But in the meantime, anybody who knows what I'm doing knows exactly what the message is. The message is not my saying I support Hillary. My message is saying what I propose happens. And she happens to be doing it. What's wrong with that? I also say critically, what's wrong with Obama and the Obama campaign? What's wrong with that? I talk about McCain, and I don't call him Coke McCain, because that would confuse him with George Bush. You know? So it's not necessary. As a matter of fact, the enemy would all have fits about this, of trying to hammer her all the harder with all the people that hate me, would immediately desert her and do terrible things to her. So what good does it do? This is not the case of that kind of politics. It's a case, yes, each of us must do what is our mission. Our mission is determined by what we do anyway, what our capabilities are, and what the effect of our, in our own name, doing something. So those are all to go together. My purpose is to save the United States. And by what I'm doing, obviously, does implicitly help her, because she uses it. It's to her advantage. She deals with the lower 80%. The competition does not. I promote the lower 80%. It's all very clear. And I try to make clear things which he needs to know and other people need to know. And by just putting them out as things that people need to know, she gets them automatically. So she's not deprived of anything from me. If I were to publicly endorse her, you do realize what would happen to her support? They would target her as never before. That is not useful.
I will say that we have more questions like that from Clinton delegates than any other topic, except, don't you think Dick Cheney really is responsible for killing the DC madam? that would actually be grounds for anyone hanging themselves. Okay. So the next question. Mr. LaRouche, I have two questions for you pertaining to the economy. I should mention that this question is submitted from Representative Priscilla Taylor from the Florida House of Representatives. She is the representative who introduced the HBPA into the Florida legislature. Her two questions are, she says, I've been following the debate on the gasoline crisis and the proposed lifting of the gas tax. Hillary wants the tax holiday. Obama opposes it. What do you think? What can we do now immediately that will have some benefit for the population? Second, I know your HBPA has passed many cities and states. Right now, Congress has refused to act on that measure. However, I just heard that they had their own bill. Her grammar's a little odd. Essentially, what she's saying is that Bush has said that he will veto the relief bill that the Democrats have put forward. She says, therefore, does this give us a new opportunity for the HBPA, or are there other more pressing questions?
As I say, I'm looking at this strategically. I'm not looking at this mechanically. And I think a lot of we Americans are so conditioned by news things and news media and whatnot, we come up with mechanical approaches. If you do this, you do that, you know, is the little wheel run by faith and the big wheel run by the grace of God, or the other way around, right? It doesn't function that way. We're in a power game. It's not influencing this guy, influencing that guy. These are all the mechanics, we know about them, but they really are not what determines the way political processes work. what you have to think about is how do you set into motion processes which control the way things happen. Now, my problem with this is that I try to educate a lot of people in Riemannian dynamics as the way to explain how to deal with some of these questions. But people don't know Riemannian dynamics. And thus, I can offer them a scientific solution for an approach, but they don't understand it because they still are thinking in Cartesian terms, which most people think of. That's why most economists are incompetent when it comes to forecasting. And some are just incompetent per se, whether forecasting or not. But the point is what I'm trying to do, first of all, I'm trying to formulate statements of policy, which the person who doesn't understand Riemannian concepts would be able to understand and use. And that's what I'm trying to do on that point. Because I have a hopelessly illiterate population in terms, especially even in high levels of authority, on the questions of economics. There is no professional competence in economics in the United States today. There are people who work as economists who have specific kinds of competence because they're smarter, because they do the work. But in terms of principles of economics, there is no body of people in the United States who today are practicing economists who know what the hell they're doing. And if you tell them what to do, they wouldn't know what it is. They're just not competent. So therefore, the compromise is to set forth which I'm involved with, and which some people around me are involved with, is specifying things which, as packages, will work. They're practical, and therefore they act as temporary substitutes for the incompetence of people in thinking about principles of economics. That's the way it has to work. That's why I'm so overloaded, because this thing confronts me. People in economics today are just incompetent. They don't know what it is. They all think they know something about it, but they don't know anything about it. What I do is try to educate people in a package which will work and explain why and how it will work, but otherwise, without my direct instruction, they haven't got a clue as to what to do. That's a problem. And that's why I do what I do, is because it's important that this be done, therefore I try to do it. And I'm also engaged in trying to get some young people who I will not be live forever. Contrary to rumors, I will not live forever. to come along and pick up the slack and develop a broader base of education to produce people who are competent in the principles of physical economy. But those who try to interpret, design economy in terms of monetary systems haven't got a clue. They're beaten from the start. There's no way that you can define a rational system of economy on the basis of monetary economy. It cannot be done by the nature of the thing. This is very extremely important, so I'm going to qualify it in this way. That economy is physical. It is not monetary. Now, we have monetary systems which are used to manage exchange, wage rates, things of that sort. They're monetary systems, but they are not economic systems. They're monetary systems which function within certain false or true assumptions about what an economy is. An economy is physical. Now, most people don't pay attention to the most important thing about an economy. No monkey ever had one. No chimpanzee ever had an economy. Because economy is a reflection of the effect of the creative powers of the human mind. Now, most people don't know what creative is. They probably studied Descartes. They don't know what creative is. They believe in Euclid. They don't know what creative is. They studied this science or other. They don't know anything. So therefore, the problem is that the economy is determined by physical things. Physical processes, which include things like we call infrastructure, we call it agriculture, we call it industry, We call it transportation systems as a very specific kind of infrastructure and so forth. And the in economy, the secret is how to get these things to mesh together to one end. First of all, to promote the increase of the productive powers of labor, which is largely a promotion of a mental capability. The same creativity we associate with creativity, which no animal has. Human beings have creativity. Most people don't know what creativity is. They call anything creativity. A child makes a smudge on a wall, they call it creative. So, but a physical economy is a concatenation of the relationship of physical things and practices which are used as media of allowing discoveries by mankind to be employed by these facilities to increase the productive powers of labor per capita per square kilometer. It's physical. Now, what you do in monetary side, you create a money system, as under the American system, and then you manage the way in which you price things by protectionist methods. And without protectionism, there's no sanity. In order to make this machinery of production, of increasing the productive powers of labor, work. In other words, you have to build a machine. The machine is a physical machine, but the physical machine is driven by genius. It's driven by the human genius of discovering principles which can be translated into benefits. Those benefits then depend upon creating an apparatus like the creation of a transcontinental railway system. What does it do? Well, it transforms, it takes and reduces the cost of production and enables one to use the whole territory of a nation usefully where you couldn't without railroads. The first approximation before that was water systems, inland water systems. Inland water systems were the precedent for railroads. We came along, but inland water systems do not have a high speed. If they do have a high speed, you don't want to ride in them. So railway systems run at a higher speed, and therefore we are able more efficiently and quicker to move things that we could not move with that same amount of human effort before. For example, going from coal to coke is an improvement. Going from coke to petroleum is an improvement. Going from petroleum to nuclear power is a big improvement. It's a great leap, which means that everything else is doing the same thing, so to speak, but now with a driver of a nuclear power in there, suddenly you've multiplied the power of the human being per capita per square kilometer. That's economics, real economics. Now, the other factor of a real economy is that you have to provide freedom for it. What's freedom for? Is it in order to please people, to give them this or that? No, no. The point is, freedom in science means creativity in the same sense as discovery of a universal physical principle. That's freedom. The ability to break through from a limit of behavior and discovery and insight to find a new power which the human mind can control and apply practically, which increases man's power to exist in this universe or overcomes a deficit in that respect. So therefore, that's what our drive is. Genius, the mind, creative powers of mind is the source of economy. It's what makes the difference between a baboon and a human being. You can tell that way. If somebody disagrees with me, they're probably a baboon. So therefore, that's economy. The monetary side then is you get these relationships, and based on these relationships, the physical relationships, you now set up a set of numbers, a protectionist system, which works, which means that the money flow in the system corresponds to the objectives of the system as a whole. That in the old days in the United States, that was approximated by the factory management section of a production as opposed to Wall Street. Wall Street was always a pain in it. But the factory management was to design a system of producing products integrated with the market, which would actually increase the productive powers of labor. That is, you would get a benefit to the user of a product, because the product enabled the users of the product to have some benefit which is measurable and physical benefit for the society. So that's, but that concept, this understanding of this is lacking. And thus, when we discuss many of these questions that touch on economics or as well as dealing with it directly, you're dealing with a problem of the intrinsic incompetence of the conceited fellow who thinks because he read a book about economics or got a lecture on it, he knows what it is. He has no understanding whatsoever. Economics is related to what? The human mind. And the human mind has a power that no animal has. It is the human mind which is the source of creativity, the creativity which increases the productive powers of labor. And it's the design of the physical systems which we operate, including streets, highways, water systems, so on, the design of these systems, their proportion, their interaction, is based on the utilization of the powers of mind to increase the power per capita productivity of man. And you design a monetary system then, or a price system, which fits that. So the flows of money correspond to the physical benefit for mankind. And that's what I teach, and I hope other people will be enlisted into becoming masters in that. And that's what the problem is going to bring this subject up. They think of the wrong thing.
Okay. We still have a very large number of institutional questions from the United States, including from Congress, from various state legislators and from trade unionists, but I do want to try to work in some of the international questions that we're getting. And we just have a huge number of questions coming in via the internet and also from here on Africa. Just to kind of put several of them together, it says, Lynn, what is your solution to the problem that you refer to in Africa, where the growth of the African population is seen as a threat to the international financiers' control of raw materials? Do you believe that there is a difference between the Anglo-Dutch financier oligarchy and the government of Great Britain? Because many people in Africa really don't see any difference between the two. Considering the food and financial problems that Africa faces, if right now you were standing anywhere on the African continent, what would you say to the African people?
Well, I probably would stand in Zimbabwe, because that's the best place from which to insult the British. And they would believe it. The point is, people have to think clearly about this. Right now, what's the problem? Africa has a land area which is intrinsically agricultural in its primary potential, which is one of the major sources of food of the planet. Where's the food? Well, some things eat the food. Diseases affect the food. In the process of transportation, or lack of process of transportation, lack of efficient food handling devices, food actually grown is lost, sometimes before it comes to maturity, sometimes afterward. You have diseases in Africa which are not treated, not only diseases of plants and animals, but diseases of people. Therefore, you have a loss there. For example, the AIDS, so-called, effect in certain parts of Africa wiped out especially the better educated part of the population of African nations. That's another problem. And so therefore, I've taken the view toward Africa of saying, let's talk about infrastructure. The first one you talk about is water management. Then it's very important. Then you talk about transportation, because without transportation systems, you cannot manage the delivery of things which are necessary to increase the productivity of agriculture. In other words, don't try to start by saying we're going to increase the productivity of the farmer per se. First of all, let's take the farmer, African farmer, as he exists with his existing culture. Let's say, what can we do in terms of infrastructure which will cause an increase in the productivity of that farmer without changing him otherwise? Well, kill some of the diseases that kill the food. Preserve the food that is grown and is destroyed because of various reasons. Create the infrastructure. I would say create an internal transportation network for Africa, which links it together in such a way that these problems can be addressed. For example, you go into some part of Africa. You've got a disease in this area. You've got a farmer who's growing. A couple of farmers are growing in a community. But they have no local facility to assist them. And the local facility, if it existed, couldn't assist them because there's no transportation system to support it. You want to save food. For example, you could use nuclear radiation and other things. If you want to, you want to preserve food that's grown, say crop food. All right. What would you do with it? You would probably put it in a big sack, and you would probably irradiate it. Now, you wouldn't use that product for seed. It wouldn't be good shape. You use radioactive isotopes, which was developed as a technique. So now you're concerned to save the food, so you package it, and you move it efficiently to places where it's going to be consumed or otherwise utilized. And that is, in general, the approach. Where there isn't water, you need water management. For example, some very fairly elementary, not simple, but elementary, work on the Nile system would actually increase the productivity of Sudan. Now, Sudan is, in territory, the largest nation of Africa. And therefore, and its territory is such, you have various climates, but the territory in the large north area is such that a very small amount of increment of water available in any given repeated years suddenly turns what is relatively a desert into a fairly productive grain-producing area, and some other things as well. So sometimes I would say, coming in from the outside, from a European culture going into Africa, what do we know that they can use which would be most beneficial for them? Don't go in there and try to change them. Work with them and try to find ways of things that they can understand and use, which will enable them to decrease the losses from their effort and decrease the losses of food once they've grown it. Because I think that's the first step. And then look, with that approach, you say, what are we going to do three generations ahead? What's our perspective? We've got the African farmer now and other Africans, but let's take the African farmer as a type. What are we going to do to make sure that his grandchildren are going to have the kind of life which he would aim for? And I would say, as European civilization, rather than going in and trying to give them too much advice, the better way would go in and give them the infrastructure and technology they need to improve the power of productivity of what they're able to do with their own existing skills now.
Okay, and the next question is from John Jeffries from the Machinists Union in Louisville, Kentucky. He says, Lynn, we're making every effort to get the HBPA passed here in Louisville, and we will continue to do so. And I have some questions for you. One is, what actually were the similarities of the times in 1933 to today? My question pertains particularly to the housing market and to banking in general. Debt obligations of mortgage-backed securities, I don't think were an issue in 33, or were they? My real question is, what are the differences in the two situations, and is our current situation worse than the situation in 33? If so, how?
Yeah, the situation today is worse in the sense of morality. The population today is less moral. Now, there you had, think of the composition. You have what, in the United States in the 1920s, about 40% rural agricultural. You had a rapid growth under Roosevelt of, well, rapid, you're talking about 5-6 years, that sort of thing, of increase in productivity. What's needed, essentially, is that we have to recognize that money as we define it today, at today's prices, is essentially worthless. We're in hyperinflation now. The rate of increase of inflation per week of prices is already hyperinflationary. We're headed for a 1923 Germany type of situation. The rate of inflation is going to increase. The rate, you take the case of food, the rate of shortage of food is going to increase. It's built into the present structure. So therefore, in that time, Roosevelt had an easier time than we have today, because in then, he had a task of reviving production, which took about a decade on his part. Today, we have the problem of stopping a declivity in productivity. That's the difference. Therefore, the challenge is greater. I think it's soluble in the sense that we can mobilize and motivate people as we could not before. We can do it because the situation is so damn bad that people are willing to make that extra effort to find a solution for a problem. It's not casual. They will actually fight hard to save civilization. And that's our best shot. The other thing is, as we know with the youth movement in particular, my experience with it, we have a potential out there in terms of people, especially, you know, take the age group of 25 to 35. That's the organic leadership layer in our society today. The potential intelligentsia from this age group, that's the leadership. That's where it comes from. And especially because this is the generation which reached into adulthood about the time of the 2000 election, when you had a significant movement on campuses, as I saw in the election campaign year of that period, a significant movement among university youth. A significant, I mean, don't mean majority, I mean something. Better than nothing, something. And I found it inspiring, and I sat out and said, well, we've got to get serious about this, because there are these young people out there. They're entering adulthood or are already adults. They have an orientation. They're getting crap for education. They got courses which they have a sense of losing their mind every time they attend the class, you know, in some new way. It's what it's like. And therefore, we have to do something to organize them as a political force for science, for ideas, as well as for politics and such. But they have to be organized around a mission orientation. What are you going to do with your life? You know, you become 18, 20, so forth. What are you going to do with your life? Not what are you going to do? What are you going to do with your life? Is the fact of your existence an embarrassment to you? What are you going to do with your life? So you have to have a mission orientation, which is, in a sense, a surrogate for a commitment to fight war. You're fighting war not to kill, but you're fighting a kind of war to mobilize people to achieve goals, to achieve missions, or to define missions that ought to be obtained. And that's the way we have to approach this kind of thing, is get this across. And I think we can mobilize by mobilizing people for accelerating. Look, I know, and we know from, people could tell you what we do in the basement, for example, that we know that you can accelerate the creative development of the creative powers of people by these kinds of programs. We have been experimenting, in a sense, with doing just that. It works. It's not perfect, it's obvious, it works. And we can increase the productive powers of people, we can increase their ingenuity, and that's what we have to do. So I think, in answer to the question, which has complicated aspects, the point is, the situation today is worse than it was then. First of all, because of the social composition of the labor force, which is less suited to production. Secondly, because we have some talented young people who are affected adversely by their experience of life because of their generation situation. That life out there, that society out there is a bog. It's a mess. It's a swamp. And even young people who are bright, talented, motivated, do not have access to the kind of environment in which the creativity in them is easily developed. Two things working against them. And my intent was to try to create the idea of how do you protect these young people who show talent? How do you get them to develop by protecting them? Protecting them from boomers, for example, from the influence of boomers. There's nothing more than a bunch of academic boomer professors of the type in a university to destroy a mass of human minds. That's not going to go into that, but I could at great length. So therefore, by creating the environment for mission task-oriented goals, I think we can accelerate a cadre of young people who can become the intellectual leaders of the next generation. I'm talking about people who are entering 25 to 35 age group. I think we can do it. And if we can get them moving, we can then take the younger people between 18 and 25 and begin to influence them in a positive way. I was very optimistic about the 18 to 25 age group back in 2000. But the degeneration in the culture of the United States since the year 2000, now 8 years later, is such that the possibility of taking people in the 18 to 25 group and getting them to progress is more, much greater, more difficult than it is, was then.
Then the next question is from Dr. Luis Light, who is the former USDA Director of Dietary Guidance. And Dr. Light says, Mr. LaRouche, according to the United Nations Global Policy Forum, the world produces enough food to feed every person alive today. So why are we seeing the greatest worldwide hunger and starvation epidemic ever recorded, with one out of every six people in the world at immediate risk for severe malnutrition and death by starvation? This is not only immoral, but it is breeding war and revolution in every known country where this massive hunger exists. We know two things. When people have the capacity to grow most of their own food and live in stable communities, they are not malnourished, they don't starve to death, and barring any unexpected catastrophe like war or weather-related disaster, they're okay. The second thing we know is that this global hunger catastrophe is man-made. It was created by the WTO and others who have globalized monoculture and restricted farming by rules that favor the needs of the affluent and ignore those of the poor. My question to you is, who has decided which people will live and who will die by dictating such stupid, arrogant, and murderous world trade policies?
Well, one thing I disagree with, I think the food supply today is really in jeopardy. And Helga, my wife, has been working with a number of people in Europe on this question, leaders in relevant areas, with backgrounds in government and so forth, relevant kind of professions. And we have here a center in Leesburg, where we're doing some work there, which is also quite relevant to the same thing, which is on the history of this food problem. We do have actually we have obviously the potential for adequate food supply. That's the basis for optimism. But the point is, we've destroyed that potential. We destroyed its organization. Such, for example, a winter wheat crop from some parts of the United States, it was not there. The product was not there. It will not be there. It will not be there. So the food is not there. And what we're getting all over the world is there's been a cover-up, including the information, a systemic cover-up of the fact of the growing net food shortage in production in the world today. It's a lie. Otherwise, what the question posed is correct. And we're assuming that these conditions did not exist, which are contrary to some of the reports out. The reports are fraudulent. But otherwise, the question is correct. We need a program, and what the purpose is of the focus among Europeans in particular, which we're working to try to get the American side of people involved in now on this, is to focus on the period into the June meeting of the FAO and to build a head of steam around that meeting to force a change in what had been the original intention of this FAO session, based on the fact that people who are concerned with food and so forth are now realized that they've got to get rid of the WTO, got to get rid of biofuels and these kinds of things, and got to get rid of the idea of taking certain areas of the world and restricting which areas can produce what food and deny the right to produce food in those other areas. For example, the case in the clearest case in the case of Sonora. You have Prince Philip, the dung heap of the royal family, who, with his World Wildlife Fund, is a genocidal organization. We have in Sonora area, with the Plano area, we have the ability now, based on engineering which has been done by Mexican engineers for a long period of time, we know the water potential, we can actually produce an expansion of food production in that area. One of the more opportune choices, but it's prevented by the British government, by the British monarchy, through Prince Philip's World Wildlife Fund and other means. So our problem is that we are destroying the natural potential for growing food at the same time that we are prohibiting people from growing it. And we, you know, destroying the means by which it could be grown. Therefore, we have to act and get those criminals out of the system. We have to send Prince Philip back to Satan where he belongs.
Lynn, we have we've gotten a lot of questions concerning the production of food for domestic markets versus international markets, and this in a sense reflects it. This question was submitted by Senator Joey Pendleton, who is the minority whip of the Kentucky State Senate, and who also is a co-sponsor of SR 90, which is the Kentucky Homeowners and Bank Protection Act, that he and Senator Perry Clark passed through the Kentucky Senate on the final day of the session in a Republican-controlled Senate, they add. Okay, so he says, Lynn, in addition to my service in the legislature, I'm an active farmer, and I also serve on the faculty of the Murray State University Agricultural Program. As I'm sure you know, farmers today face a horrific crisis. We're seeing rising prices for fuel, fertilizer, and virtually everything we need to farm. We're responsible for feeding our nation, and frankly, we do have to feed part of the world. I agree that using corn for ethanol is not viable. We have to move back to using corn for the food supply. The question that I have is how can we feed the world with the rising cost of production and yet, at the same time, keep food cheap for the domestic market? What is your idea on how to keep farmers in America farming, to keep them in business, and to provide our own nation with a supply of cheap, good food for the table?
Okay. We got a couple of problems here. First of all, when you reduce the productivity of an economy, you do not lower the overhead costs of maintaining that economy. When you have fewer people working as a percentile of the total population, you are increasing the cost of existence. If you restrict production, you are increasing the cost of production. Because for this reason. On top of that, the prices of products are not based on cost. That is not physical cost. If you take the physical cost that goes in it, including everything, and starting from a certain average price of labor, and measuring the equivalent of price of labor with cost, if you do that, you discover that most of the price increases today that the questioner talked about really are not real. They're speculative. They're monopolistic. For example, the way what the British do, the idea is very old. Create a shortage and raise the price by creating a shortage. Now, by raising a shortage, you have two ways of increasing the price. First of all, you have a speculative or monopolistic increase in price. You have a monopoly, you can bid the price up. You can steal money. Not because the cost has risen, but because the price has risen. And the cost that's risen is the parasite, the cost of the parasite who does the stealing. That's the way it works. So therefore, the other way is to reducing, by monopolistic method, reducing the baseline of net production of the entire economy. That is, you have a given population. How much product can that population generate, useful product? Well, obviously, that's a factor of technology and of policy, a policy of product employment. If you are not advancing technology, if you're reducing the amount of production, and so forth, the costs of maintaining society then become reflected, including the parasitical costs, become reflected inversely in the price of the product that you're producing. So therefore, the general point is to have a rational maximization of production, in which you always have an overproduction. But also you maintain production to distribute it in as many areas of the world. For example, like petroleum. The petroleum business is absolutely insane. The British, actually, the petroleum as a product was invented by Mendeleev, who created the Baku oil things in Russia. It was his design. But the petroleum was then used by the British Navy in preparation for World War I. And they discovered that they had, if they could make cruisers, British cruisers, which were oil-burning rather than coal-burning. And the gain was such that this gave them greater range and increased the sea power of the British Navy. So the British took a part of the Middle East, which is now called Kuwait, which is actually British petroleum. And they took this area and tried to use that as a lever. Then, by encouraging the development of the use of petroleum, by pushing automobiles rather than rail systems. Now, when you use trucks, for example, highway trucks as a replacement for rails, you increase the cost greatly, vastly. But you eliminate the rail system, and you have to use the trucks. Now, therefore, the social costs of maintaining the transport of goods zooms out of the inefficiencies you've generated. This is the kind of problem we face. If you think, forget the money thing. Don't assume that the price is right. The price is often a thief's price. But don't assume that. So, therefore, if you look at it in physical terms, then the things become obvious. If you start to measure economy by taking an average price of labor, which you measure in commodity content, that is a family household. You start with a family. Somebody's working. They're in a family. You take a normal family. They require, make a table, everything, education, so forth, put it in there. Get your average cost of maintaining a human being in that society to be productive, or a family to produce productive. Think about how you optimize the cost of production, and effectively lower the effective cost of production. Then it all becomes fairly simple. So don't move product all over the world. Diversify your product production rationally. Use every part of the world that is suitable for a certain kind of production locally. Don't use petroleum as much. Use it as a feedstock. Petroleum is an excellent feedstock for chemicals and many other things. Do it that way. Don't haul it all around the world at a great markup and then say that's the cost of production. It's not. So we use nuclear power, higher energy flux and density. Use that. You change the production. Everybody's more productive. The cost declines because cost is relative to the cost of maintaining a human being. So therefore, if you make people more productive, the cost of maintaining a human being in terms of product is cheaper. And don't let the parasites get in and steal. Then the prices will not go up. It's very simple. Good government, good understanding of how economies work is sufficient. And the problem is we do not have that problem. We do not have the problem. We have the problem only to the degree that you have mismanagement. It's not a feminist movement. It's something else.
Okay, I'm going to take all the questions that we have, which are many, from state legislators and from city councilmen and others, all of which ask Lynn specifically what to do about the price of oil, specifically what to do about the price of gas, specifically what to do about the price of food, specifically what to do about the price of housing, and specifically what to do about the fact that we have a rotten economy, and give them all to Lynn to take home. because I think he's answered most of them, and I think that people can find the answers to these questions in terms of specifics on the website. But I also think that there is a higher principle that needs to be addressed. Lynn, the last question I'm going to put to you is kind of a composite question that's come from a number of members of the LaRouche youth movement here in the United States, but it also reflects questions that have come from them around the world. And I think that it's a question that's worth asking. Lynn, I understand why Hillary Clinton might be the least bad candidate for the presidency in the United States, but it is also just hard to get excited about her. Even though she falls way short of what's needed in this crisis, she apparently is still way too much for the financial oligarchy, maybe because they worry about your influence on her. My worry is that even if she managed to win the presidency, as far as I can tell, the only way she'd be able to do that would be to make so many rotten deals and compromises with really bad people that she wouldn't be a very good president anyway. I don't know, maybe I'm wrong. I don't have that much experience in politics. But my question to you is that maybe there is some other way for us to affect the general future of civilization other than politics. Maybe the whole political theater is just too dirty and too corrupt for us to make an impact. I want to maintain a sense of optimism about the future, but looking at the political framework, I'm having trouble doing that.
Well, the field is troublesome because it's a field of conflict, not because it's intrinsically difficult. The problem here, you know, Hillary doesn't really have a problem of that type described. Not really. She may have psychologically, at the present time, a sense of difficulty of that type, but it doesn't exist. See, when you are president of the United States, under our Constitution, you are not in a contract society. The president is not in a contract society with the population. The president is like a commander in warfare, which is one of his powers. And therefore, he's supposed to respond to what is required by the situation, taking the present and future into account. That's his job. So therefore, the president can say, well, ladies and gentlemen, you know, when I was running for a campaign last year, I had a number of ideas, and some of them I think we ought to junk. Because on reflection, either they were wrong, our judgment was wrong at the time, and now with new information we find we were wrong, and we're going to change that. Besides, there were some other things we came up with we didn't discuss last year, and we're going to have to do that. So we do that. Now, that would be the way a Franklin Roosevelt would approach a situation like this. It's to say, you know, last year I was a damn fool. I wasn't the only damn fool, though, I'll tell you that. I was the least damn fool. And you're lucky, because you got the least damnable fool, me. And therefore, I come to my senses. I've been struck. I come to my senses. And therefore, I'm telling you, we're going to cancel this. Stop worrying it. I'm not nuts. I'm not going to stick with this. If I were a nut, I would stick with it, what I said last year. But not being a nut, I'm not going to stick with what I said last year. You're voting for me because you trust me. You trust me as an executive of this nation who can make mistakes and did make mistakes. But he has the ability to recognize a mistake and correct it. That's the best you can get. You get a couple of genius strokes, which are really revolutionary, and they're perfect. But for the greater part, you have to address in the heat of battle, in the heat of conflict, in the heat of crisis, you've got to respond to any situation, either by saying it's not important, we're going to live with the suffering, or we're going to do something about it. And you're going to come up with most of the things you decide are actually approximations, not perfection. And you find, if we say, take the case of China. China's gone through a number of changes since the days of Mao Zedong. Deng Xiaoping was a success, but there were problems. So a successive generation attacked a different set of problems, and so forth and so on. In the normal course of life of a government, if it's well run, this is the nature of things. You have to deal with certain things which you may have a long view of what your objectives are. And I think that Deng Xiaoping, in part, had a long view or reflected a long view. But at the same time, you have to make decisions in the short term or the medium term because they have to be made. You don't have as much knowledge as you need to make a good decision, but you've got to do something. You do it. You do it knowing you may be making a mistake. You tell people, say, maybe I'm mistaken, but this is the best I can do, and we have to do something. You got a better suggestion? That's good government. But at the same time, there's another level, which there are certain things which are matters of principle. Is how do you, what is government? What should government be? What's the meaning of our Constitution? For example, the question of war. Today, in the oligarchical system, like the British system, like Cheney, are looking for a war. Now, a good government may conduct a war, but it's not looking for wars as a matter of policy. It's looking to prevent wars. It's doing everything possible to avoid those damn wars. The Treaty of Westphalia taught the lesson to anybody who's got any brains. You don't go out to kill the other. You go out to solve the problem and try to find a way of circumventing the conflict. You deal with people who are in governments which stink, but you don't kill them or go to war with them because they stink. You try to find a way to deal with the problem because you know the cost of war. The first cost of war is it breeds hate. And hate curses society. Hate against others is hateful. So therefore, you avoid war. The first thing you're concerned about when you fight war, if you're any damn good, is you're concerned, are you going to provide for the care of the person you were shooting yesterday who is now your captive? Are you going to treat them fairly and honestly? As the Treaty of Westphalia prescribes. That's the point. So Hillary has no problem if she's president. She can say she was a damn fool, and people would probably love her for it.
Well, in closing, what I would say is that if people in the audience, people in the movement, people who are listening over the internet find that they can't get excited about Hillary or about Barack Obama or about John McCain, or at least not excited about them in any positive way, then certainly you can get excited about Lynn, and you can get excited about what Lynn has had to say today and about LaRouche PAC, and you can show that excitement in two ways. One is by giving money so that we can continue to do what we're doing and do it on a much larger scale. The other is that if you can't give money, you can go out and find someone who can. You can volunteer your time. That's what we need you to do right now. We need you to be an organizer and a fighter in this war. These are obviously difficult times, but I think also there's a clear path that we can take to victory. I hope you'll join me in thanking Lynn for this remarkable presentation, and then I hope you'll get to work.